here. I'm with the Economic Development Forest Industry Coordinator for Aiken County, and I guess the chair of our broadband community. And I want to thank everybody for coming. Now I'll just turn it over to my right.
Okay, I'm Ann Tracy, and I help with the Blended on Broadband blog, so I'm kind of recording notes for today.
Mary Magnuson with the Blended Foundation.
Monique Lampke with the City of Palisade.
Daryl Mishler, working with the City of Palisade.
Maureen Mishler, no relation.
I didn't sign.
Executive Director for CARE and also working on the Palisade project as well.
I'm Eileen Domingue. I'm a career counselor here at the Aiken Workforce Center.
Bernadine Jocelyn with Blended Foundation.
Bob Markham. I've been working at Long Lake Center lately, a few other projects.
I'm Joel Hoppe. I'm on the ARDC.
And I'm Rachel Howell. I am the Assistant Director of the East Central Regional Library, which has a branch here in Aiken.
I'm Carrie Paulson with the Workforce Center, and I also am on the Aiken Chamber Board of Directors, Economic Development Committee for the Chamber. And I want to introduce Denise Rogers. She's on mute right now, or maybe not. Are you on mute?
Hello. Hi.
I put her on the big screen when we're doing our program updates.
And I'm Bill Coleman here on behalf of Blended Foundation.
Thank you. Well, that turns us over to meeting purpose, and I'm just kind of going by your template here. So what I did is put together just kind of a PowerPoint on our projects, and some of the people in attendance will speak to them. Not everybody could be here. So when you're done, Bernadine, we'll just go into that, and I know that is what Denise is waiting for. We got her right on
top
great. Of the agenda.
Well, it's just so much more fun and helpful for us to come and be with you here in person and, you know, get a chance to kind of just say hello to everybody. Happy New Year. I think it's, you know, we haven't been together, and just touch base, see how it's going, what's worked well, what hasn't, where we're at. So it's just, we're here just to kind of listen, and we're going to be listening for opportunities and ways that we can continue to support the good work you're doing, and of course answer any questions and talk a little bit about the future. So again, it's just wonderful to be feel so welcome in this beautiful space, and we look forward to hearing what you have to report since we were last together.
Okay, anybody else want to throw anything out before we get going, or no?
Oops, sorry. I got
a. You deleted the base.
Yeah,
she went away.
Hold on. I'm learning this as we go. All right. I'm going to move you over, Denise, onto the big screen, okay? And you're going to be up.
Go to screensaver.
And Denise, her focus is on long distance learning, which is so exciting.
Wow.
Cool.
All right. Can you hear us, Denise? We kind of got a little leg. Can you hear us?
Somebody's on mute.
Well, we can't hear her.
Hold on. I got to go over here.
We'll get these things ironed out. Trust us.
Yes. Can you hear us?
You're modeling by learning.
That's right.
It's great.
Hi, Denise.
Okay.
Okay. We still can't hear you.
Are you muted, Denise?
There we go.
Yeah. Okay. All right, I'm going to make you think now.
Okay. All right, well, hello, everybody.
Hello.
I'm glad to be with you in Aiken right now. So I just wanted to share a little bit about what this opportunity has brought forth. Carrie approached me about this quite a few months back, and I love the idea about PCs for people. We had done something similar in the Virginia area through AEOA, and we were able to get computers out to students. And I had a student who, she lived in Deer River and would travel to Grand Rapids, and it was really tough. She was a young girl, and we were able to get her a PC. And then she just started doing a lot of online classes and really could just whiz through the material and got her GED. And so it was exciting to think that we could do that in Aiken, and there was definitely a need, absolutely. And it was great to see that we could get the computers to McGraw. And that was something that I really had zero experience with. I had done some webinars or go-to trainings for professional development, but I never interacted with students on the computer like this before. And so I talked to Melanie DeBay from ISD UAT. She's the community education director, and she has a lot of experience with telepresence and go-to meetings. And after a little bit of coaching from her, I took it to my classroom. And I just experimented with the Grand Rapids students, and then I started experimenting with the Aiken students. And we have successfully been having online class since the beginning of January. It's been great. I actually had a student from Aiken this morning who called in and joined me in the chat room. And it's just been really good because typically I would be in Aiken 1 or 2 days a week, and now my students have access to our online classroom every day, Monday through Friday. So it's been a great experience so far. Do you have any questions about the technology or questions about the experience?
We have her contact info here, don't we?
Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
Good. We got a project that's probably good.
I'd like to know what classes Denise is teaching.
Sure. So I'm teaching a few online classes or distance learning classes. So I teach a reading skills class in the morning, and so that's students who are below a 12th grade reading level, and we go through several different readings. And for example, this week we're going through smart consuming, and so we're doing a lot of readings on how to save money, how to set a budget, make a spending plan, how to save money in the store, those kinds of things. And then in the afternoons, I'm offering a Start Your Career class where we do a lot of, for example, we talk to students about job searching skills. And then in the afternoon, I teach a money management class called Dollars and Cents. And it's also kind of mixed in with math in general. And so the goal would be that students, if they would take any of these classes, it would prep them for a few different things. It would prep them for the GED. It would prep them for preparing for that AccuPlacer if they chose to go to college, or else it will give them the computer skills that they need to be successful in the workplace.
Another piece that Denise is doing is on Mondays, she's going to be able to remote in now because we teach alternative education students from Aiken High School. They come over here and they work on job readiness skills. So now Denise, who's not here on Mondays anymore, she'll be able to remote in and be a part of that class. So that's really exciting.
Right, and it's just been really fantastic because there's been a few, there was this one day where I was supposed to come in and it was just nasty weather. There was snow all the way across. Quite a few of the school districts had closed up north, or not closed, but they had gone 2 hours late. And so typically that would be my drive time, you know, and so I was able to remote in instead of drive in, which was really nice.
What kind of internet speed do we need to do this?
Yeah. You know, really not that much. Less than 10 megabits.
Okay, so yes.
We tried to put it up on the expander to full screen, and there wasn't enough bandwidth. Mm-hmm.
This morning there was.
Yeah.
We had a
probably Anne is probably doing something on her computer that's like.
We're going to want to be
uploading video or something.
Exactly what I'm doing.
We'll increase our Wi-Fi hotspots. We could actually get a spot here in the conference room. So we have with economic development, there's always people bringing computers so that they can do what they need to do, and we weren't able to do that before. So it worked out pretty slick.
If you need some research and investigation on that, let me know.
Okay.
How do the students start to use the technology without a blink, or is there some learning process?
Troubleshoot and help us figure it out. Typically, the thing that the students get most confused about is, for example, how to run an application. You have to run this program and get it started, or they may get caught up on how do you get the sound to work and things like that.
Then are students able to connect to you from their homes as well?
Yes, we have a student right now in Palisades.
What kind of access do they have to have, Denise, for Wi-Fi? Or is it just a hotspot on their phone enough?
You know, I think that she probably uses her phone internet. I'm not for sure.
I've got a question for Denise about your students. Are they all the Alternative Learning Center students, or who are your students?
Well, to qualify for adult education, they need to be 17 or older and unenrolled from the school district. So these are students who would want to potentially get their high school equivalency, so they may be getting their GED, or these may be students that are just looking to improve their life skills, or they may be, wanting to improve their career skills so that they can upgrade, so that they can get a better job, things like that.
So potentially, could those be people who are in their 20s?
Many of the clients that Carrie and I have are in their 30s or older. If they have children, 18 and under, they qualify for our program that we do, MFIP and DWP, and they are required to take classes from Denise if they don't have their GED. Okay. And then Denise also offers, and maybe Denise wants to talk about this a little bit, the classes that you offer as a paraprofessional.
Food service, food safety certificate.
Oh, okay.
PCA. When people walk in, I don't think, oh, they're an adult education student, because it's all ages, truly all ages.
Right. And a lot of the students that we're working with is, they just are really rusty with their skills. And so we assess where they're at, and then we get them back to the point where they remember what they used to know how to do. For some students, it's like learning it for the first time. And so we have an assessment that we do with each student to figure out where they are for their reading, their math, and then also for their computer skills.
Let me also add, if it's okay, Denise, I do the CSET program for Aiken County, and the CSET participants now will be required to meet with Denise and do their testing and assessments. And so we can get a better placement for the CSEP participants.
I think CSEP is?
Senior Community. I'm so used to saying CSEP. Or Senior Community Service. Employment Program.
Community
Senior Employment Program?
Yeah, we've had a lot of luck with the CSEP participants. Essentially, with that program, or older, and you need some sort of on-the-job training. And so we assess them to see where they're at, and then we work on their skills, such as like their reading skills and their math skills. And then once they have reached a certain level, we level our students. For example, I may have a student who starts out with a ABE level 4, right there, 4, and we want to get them to an ABE level 6. Once they've reached an ABE level 6 in reading and in math, then what we do is then we can place them into a position. For example, we have a CSEP member right now who she started out doing 4 hours of out of 20. She was volunteering for Project Read up in Grand Rapids area. And then when she was able to level up to ABE level 6 in reading, then we expanded her hours to 8 hours. And then when she leveled up for math, then we were able to put her at 12 hours for Project Read. And the whole reason why we started her in the ABE classroom was because we wanted to make sure she was really sound academically and that she was really sound with computers. And so once she was able to do that, then she was able to move into more actual work responsibilities at
Denise, looking back, what do you wish had been different, or what would you do different, or what do you wish you'd known then that you didn't, that you know now? I mean, sort of just, you know, looking to us or others, any pearls of wisdom or learning you want to share?
Well, I think that part of my, what I realized is I had a lot of fear about teaching online. You know, it was something like I remember that every time I got onto a webinar, I was really nervous about how to do it, you know, and I'd be like, I'm not sure, I know I have to call in, or I know I have to click in, or, you know, and I think that sometimes we can, that fear can show when we're teaching our students, and so I just feel like I wish I would have known the technology better when I first started working with my students. I really hope that I didn't, you know, scare any of them off, and it doesn't seem like I have, but, you know, it's just like, for a teacher, one of the things that we say is teachers need to know the subject that they're teaching, right? And with technology, it's ever-changing. You know, it's depending on what internet browser you're using, or depending on what operating system, or depending on what product you're using, everything's different. And so, you know, I think part of it, too, is just like, I wish that I would have known it better, but then at the same time, I have to tell myself that you could think that you know everything about a program, but then you get onto a different program, and it's going to be different. So, I think that I'm learning with them, and I'm glad that my students are patient with me.
Are you seeing an uptick in customers, and maybe it was for Carrie with the new equipment and results as well, or is it too early to really get a handle on that?
Well, I think that just it's been fantastic, because students that I normally, let's say I would have only seen them one day a week, now I can see them more than that, which is huge. And so my Aiken numbers have always seemed smaller, because I'm only seeing them one or two days a week. And so I really see that this is going to be a good thing.
Thank you.
Denise, one last thing for me. Are you able to give people individualized attention through the online experience as well?
I can, yes. For example, if I needed to, I could lock the classroom so that only one student could be in at a time. And that could allow students the privacy that they need. So for example, let's say that I had a student who needed help signing up for a public support, such as SNAP or food support. What I could do is I could get them logged on, and then I can lock my classroom. That way nobody can join our classroom, and then I can give that student that individual support.
Awesome.
Yes, it's very nice that way. Another thing that I can do is I can share my screen and show them what I'm doing. I had a student who had a lot of reservations about doing online classes, because she just didn't, I had showed her once, and then she just never did it again. And so then I got her online with me in the chat room, and then I showed her how to get on again. And now this week, she's just been really efficient in getting a lot done on that website. So it just took a couple demonstrations, and then she was able to do it. So I could personalize my instruction towards her needs. And another thing that I'm doing too with students is, as they're showing questions or interests, I can actually send them specific resources. So if I had a student who was very, needed some more practice on, let's say, unit rates or something like that, I have a whole pool of resources that I can send to this student. And some of these resources may be paper resources, or they may be online quizzes or tests. They could be tutorials. They could be videos. So it's really nice, because there's so many media
I don't know if you can hear us. I applaud you, Denise. You're inspiring. That's awesome.
Well, I'm really excited because now I'll be able to join the Birch Street Center team when they have their their monthly meeting. That's always been a tough thing, is I could never be there for the meeting, and so now I can join you right for your meeting too.
Nice.
I have one comment. This is Daryl Mishler. I used to teach online for the University of Phoenix, and it was always a challenge to deal with individual students, because in our environment we had news groups, strictly news groups. There was never any face-to-face, never any one-on-one, unless I set up a separate news group, which I had to get permission from the university for. So I applaud this. This is actually phenomenal in comparison to what it was in your late 90s and early 2000s. So congratulations. Congratulations.
Good job.
Thank you.
Well, on the same setup as in McGregor, and we'll be in Hill City too when their remodeling is done. So it's exciting for the whole area to have these capabilities, and it's neat to be in our area and see that we have something like this going on instead of going to conferences and workshops and seeing what everybody else is doing and going, geez, we got to do that. How can we ever get that? So this is really nice.
When you think of the power, you know, this is obviously a big county. As we came across this morning from the Twin Cities and up through Sandstone and Fennelson or whatever, and all of a sudden you see the Aiken County sign, and Ann says, "Oh, we're almost there." I said, "Well, no, another hour plus, you know." Yeah. And the size of your county, a tool like this can be so helpful in organizing efforts like this, or you know, that instead of an hour each way on a drive and a 90-minute meeting, or even a 15-minute meeting, right? Sometimes all you need is a quick exchange of information. This technology is fabulous.
Yeah. Well, the initial plan was, as I understood, is Denise was going to call in, and I thought it was going to be a conference call. And I'm like, well, that's nice. You know, it's not exciting, but this is just so much better. You just feel more part of it more interaction. So this is way better than a call-in phone.
Please excuse our wires. This was just installed on Monday evening. Thank God for anything for staying late. We had some glitches with our vendor, hence the holes up in the wall and stuff like that. But we're going to be getting another outlet, and so it will not look like this. It will be much cleaner, hopefully, within the next 30 days. So even if I have to patch it myself.
We'll be there together. Can I just pipe in about McGregor, because I live in McGregor and I'm on the McGregor Area Chamber Board, and the chamber has been very, very generous in providing a room for us, so we will have the same technology in McGregor. And McGregor has not had adult basic education classes for, I'm guessing, like 10 years.
Wow.
So thanks to this, we can now offer adult education classes in McGregor again. And because there's a need there. There absolutely is a need, and now that need can be fulfilled. We also had a very generous, huge, gigantic donation of tables and chairs from one of my best friends. And it's a beautiful, beautiful meeting room, and if you ever want to come to McGregor and see that, I welcome you to come and see that as well. And,
very nice.
You know, the chamber has been very generous, and
we'll make a point of that. I'd very much
good.
Like to do that.
Good.
Yeah. Hey, have a meeting there.
Yeah. Yep. I would love it.
Nice.
Next time.
With champagne or something. That's a big deal. Adult Ed for the first time in 10 years. That's really significant.
Denise actually has an appointment, online appointment with one of my customers. And she'll be in McGregor with Eileen, and then she'll be remoting in with Denise, and they'll be working on some driver's training. So that's huge.
Can you also join in? So you could do a three-way?
Yep, it'll be part of our classroom.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Right. And so we could even have guest speakers come in, people who are, you know, experts or some, you know, and have them share and do presentations as well, join us in our classroom. Something I did want to mention, too, is that we've branched out to ISD 318 and also ISD 316 and ISD 317, and then, of course, McGregor as well and Aiken. So we will be able to have distance learning classes, telepresence classes in all of those school districts. So that's something I'm looking forward to. Aiken was our first step just because, you know, we're just trying the technology, and then we're branching out to McGregor. But a goal of mine would be that I could have students from Deer River, Nashua, Key Lawton, you know, McGregor, and Hill City, Aiken, all together, Big Fork. And it sounds like they're on board.
One more question. Do you have the ability to record your sessions and create a library?
Yes.
Awesome.
Cool. That's pretty exciting. The relatively small grant, you know, turns into this kind of impact. It's pretty impressive.
Yes. This rock, while you're Blandon Grant at Long Lake Center, you've rocked our world already. You have no idea. The girls out there are so thrilled. But seeing this solves one of our biggest problems. We got two things. We've got a very diverse group of people on our foundation board, and it's difficult sometimes for everybody to get there because distances are great. This, now we can do this. This is absolutely wonderful. And beyond that,
you have to update your bylaws probably.
Huh?
You have to update your bylaws.
We're in the process of, we do that at every meeting anyway.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, we have already.
we did already put it in that we can take vote remotely, you know.
Nice.
But what we also have is we have a leadership council, and it involves our Congressman Nolan, for instance, is on that, Paul Thiessen, and quite a number of our representatives, senators, and of course our Mr. Luik and Kerry Paulson would be joining us. But this they're difficult to get them ever to come to a meeting. They're either in session or they're on a mission somewhere. If your meeting is an hour, they can take that time out of their day where they're at and be here with us. Wow. And this is relatively small dollars, Bill, that we spent to get this accomplished. The payback on that was gargantuan. You know, it's...
Thanks, Bob.
So logistics.
Anything else on for Denise? We can, if not...
Oh, I did.
Thanks, Denise.
Thank you, Denise.
Thank
nice
you.
Home.
You know, everyone has their own level of digital incompetence or digital illiteracy. That's something I learned from Dana McKenzie, who's now the head of the Office of Broadband, mm-hmm. that even as a very technical person, something else comes up, and everyone has a learning curve then on that new technology. And so you just have to realize what you know and you don't know, and admit what you don't know, and
ask for help.
Or don't be afraid to just monkey around with it. You can't really hurt. Click here, click there. If it bombs, you just hit the old X and start again. So.
All right. Kay. Well, thanks, Denise.
Yep.
Thank you.
And we should applaud. Hard act to follow, Ross. You put her first. Does that mean everything else is as good or better, right? Wow. Bye.
Well, she, okay, sorry, I'm still learning this.
Sure.
Okay.
I was telling Eileen that we're modeling learning, right? And to be courageous enough to mess around with it and make mistakes is good modeling. I always, feel safe to make mistakes. It's okay.
Well, before we put the next person on the spot, and I think it's Rachel, but just these are the numbers. The grant money we received, that we just all three sites got the same equipment. It worked out to be $13,067 per site, with us approximately $6,700 match per site. So, all told, $40,000 for the whole county to be using this technology and wired in is pretty good. So, I agree. It's that might be the theme is hopefully that we were able to take this money and stretch it out and do a lot of things like this. So let's move on to the next one. And
can I just say, along with this, each location received a digital technology center. And so that's at the McGregor Chamber. And this is awesome because people watch TV. And they don't always look at flyers, but they watch TV. So that'll be at all three locations. And we can share information between locations. They can send me flyers so that we're all connected. We're a connected county.
Are you talking about the monitors?
Yeah.
So can, other little cities, City of Palisade, give you a flyer that something's coming up?
Yeah, give it to me in
Perfect.
A JPEG form.
Okay.
JPEG is the best. And then I can just copy and paste it.
I'll show you.
Yeah.
And actually, Palisade's right in the middle of McGregor Hill City and Aiken, so it's
yeah.
Guys, it everywhere.
And then I can share that with Hill City of McGregor and
Great.
From there.
Mm-hmm. Anything else, Gary, before we move on?
Maybe do you want to talk anything more about McGregor? No, you're good.
I think we've covered it.
Okay.
If you have any questions, just let me know.
We have a funny one. If you live on downtown Waller, right next to the little little boxes there, the switch, we can get 100 megs down if we want it now.
Nice.
And just slightly outside of town, it goes down a little bit. But for being a ghost town, we've got screaming internet now.
From SCI?
That's Frontier.
Oh.
Yeah, they took part of the grant. And
no, they took
not
they,
your grant.
They wired all the way over to Wakanabo
and
stuff like that. I don't know how many.
See, I still hooked my satellite because I had a... I've got both, but I haven't upgraded my Frontier service yet because I'm stuck on a contract a little while. And the satellite, by the way, satellite service has increased. It rocks.
Yeah.
It wasn't the best, before. Now it's really pretty good.
Well, we'll move on to our next project was 14 units for checkout. These are the mobile Wi-Fi hotspots. ECRL, East Central Regional Library. We'll be distributing those between the Aiken and the McGregor and other outreach locations in Aiken. The grant amount received through the IRBC was $4,530. $1,250 was a local match, and I'll just let Rachel bring us up to date and all that good stuff.
Up to date. Well, I wish I could say that we were live already and starting to have these available, but life has not been quite that cooperative with us. But that's our hope. We have branches in Aiken and McGregor and outreach stops in McGrath, Hill City, and Jacobson. And so these Wi-Fi hotspots will be made available for checkout through all five of those locations. So anywhere in Aiken County that we, have a service point. And we are anticipating that they'll be available for a typical three-week checkout period. With the idea that if there's nobody waiting, just like a book, you would then be able to renew that checkout. Our current thinking, and I can't swear that that's the length we're going to go with, but I'm thinking it. We're pretty certain that's what we're going to do. Is simply that we don't visit our outreach spots terribly frequently, and so we want people who are in one of those three locations to be able to hang on to the hotspot brick long enough so that they're not running into overdue fines or something like that, simply because the loan length is not long enough to allow for Tim and the outreach van to make their next stop. So that's the idea. I had identified what I thought was going to be a great place to, great group to work with to get our hotspots, that also has a really nice partnership with Sprint, but our IT guy is swearing up and down to me that Sprint coverage is not good enough in Aiken County to get very far off the main highways, and so I'm exploring a couple different options back up instead. So, while I'm sitting here, if anybody has really great service with their particular cell carrier in the county, I'm taking recommendations. I've got some ideas. I realize that it's not going to be great for everybody, and what we're trying to do is get the best possible cell service for the data plans for the Wi-Fi pucks.
The school in McGregor already has those. Mm-hmm. Because they can rent, the kids can take them home. And my daughter goes to school in McGregor.
Okay.
I would talk to the McGregor School District just to find out where they're, what service they're using.
Okay.
Because they also have it all on the buses.
That's good to know.
Verizon would be my guess.
Yep.
It seems to be what most people around here.
Yeah.
Okay.
Is there a charge? Have you...
right now we are anticipating that there won't be a charge involved. That these would check out to anybody who has a ECRL library card and happens to visit one of our locations here in Aiken County. So that's the idea we're going with at the moment.
I was not aware that you had outreach locations. Is that like a bookmobile or?
It's not quite that formal, but what, it's comparable. It's a van. Tim drives up, I believe it's the equivalent of every couple of weeks. I'd have to look at the schedule to give you the exact count. And people who use one of our outreach locations, Tim will have a few materials that people can browse, but the intent is that it really serves as more of a checkout spot for materials that people have already identified and placed on hold.
Oh, okay.
And then they just drive to one of the locations, pick up their material, check it out, and go about their merry way. More so than a bookmobile that might have a larger collection for browsing. Possibly with things like story time or something that go along with it. That's not what we're aiming for at this point. Pardon me. The goal is to make it easier for our county residents who live farther away from McGregor and Aiken to be able to check out materials, whether it's a book or a DVD or a CD or, shortly, a Wi-Fi hotspot. So,
Rachel, we were in Cook last week. One of the cohort teams that you're going through up there, the Grizzlies, their librarian reported to us that they're just a few weeks or a month or so ahead of you,
mm-hmm.
and their checkout thing is up and running, and they're just thrilled.
Good.
They said they had people come. Do you guys remember how far away from other towns in the region even,
mm-hmm.
and then, I forget how many devices they had, I don't remember the number, but they'd had a really positive experience with a lot of demand and
good.
Happy customers.
I know it's the other end of the state, but Rochester Public Library also offers this service. They have a charge involved for part of that service, and we wouldn't be doing that. And they've had very, very positive response from folks using
them.
Well,
I'm glad you've got peers in other places you can bounce and check with. Good.
It's great.
Yeah, it's nice having it located in other locations than Aiken and McGregor.
Mm-hmm.
And
that's
really exciting to me.
When you approached us, that was one of the things that, as we were starting our conversation, was... If we're going to offer things in McGregor and Aiken we ought to be able, and we should plan to offer them in our outreach locations as well, because if anything, some of these even tinier locations further out in the county may even be in more need of having having this this ability to get on the internet. And we don't want to deprive them of it just because they don't happen to live.
Right. And like Bill said, it could be, you could be in Bob's area or somewhere and you still got a 35, 40 mile drive to some of the locations.
So. And so that's, it's, we realize that we're, it's a far flung county, but hopefully this will work for as many people as we can help. So that's the idea at the moment.
Awesome. Well, when you get it up and running, let's make sure we get some pictures and articles in the newspaper and things like that.
You bet.
Our next project, thank you. Any other questions or anything before we move on?
Thank you for coming today and being part of this
You're
meeting.
Very welcome.
It's great to hear from you personally. Yeah.
Our next project, and I'm kind of going over the phase two ones. The first part was actually a phase one. But this was Wi-Fi enabled buses in Aiken High School through their grant of just under $5,000 and $2,000. Local match, bought four portable units, and their plan is to basically, they know their bus schedule and they know which buses are going the furthest out. They wanted to make sure that it was portable so they could move them along buses. So basically, if there's a sporting event, that bus will have the, or choir or whatever, they'll have a hotspot, and if they're not checked out or if they're not going on activity buses, then they'll move them around to the buses that have the longest rides. And again, getting onto this far-flung geographic area, we're not unlike a lot of rural districts. We have kids on the bus for 30, 40, 45 minutes one way. So it's exciting. I know the school's happy that they can put it on. I'm sure they would have liked to have done them all similar to McGregor, but this is a start, and they were satisfied. And nobody from the school could come. If you want to hit the next slide. We have a picture, and if you see it just beyond that clipboard, there is a AH bus with their Wi-Fi unit up and running and going. So that's what they have, and I'm guessing some kind of a little antenna or something on the top, or maybe not. I don't know. It's probably more than I do, Bill, if that's...
I'm not a school bus Wi-Fi expert. It looks like those have pretty good size antennas.
Yeah, it does. There,
so. Yeah. Nice. Well, that flexibility is nice, you know, to be able to move around and gives just more capacity and good judgment. And
yeah.
A lot of happy school bus drivers.
Yes, I've heard that more than once. The kids are looking down like this.
Yes.
So I guess the question I have about that is the school district thinking this is enough, or do they want to Wi-Fi their all their buses, or where? What do you think? Do you have a sense of that?
I think they're thinking this will be good. I don't think they feel they need for all of them. Some of us, you know, some never even leave town. You know, they just
sure.
They go around, they deliver to the different kids and stuff. So. My understanding or impression from working with them is if they did more, it would not be every single one. It'd just be a few more mobiles, and this will give them an idea of how it works. And so they are happy to be able to kind of get into this project without a lot of money and see how it works.
Good. Thanks.
And one of our last projects, well, we got more. I'll just keep right on. One of the issues we had at Long Lake Conservation Center, and Long Lake is a residential environmental learning center. We bring in 5,000-6,000 students a year, either through the school programs or summer camps and different things. We had two problems. There was not enough bandwidth, and there was Wi-Fi dead spots throughout, especially for some of the instructors and some of the more remote classrooms from the main antenna. Talking with our IT department, the issue was not equipment. The county had put in plenty of repeaters and this kind of stuff. Basically, there just was not enough bandwidth coming in to the system or juice to get it spread out. So the foundation actually was the applicant. Got a $2,496 grant and put up $624. Bob is here. He is the both of you. He did all the work. I kind of show up for the photo op.
I begged him for his help, but he did the majority of the writing.
This is a quote from our business manager, Wendy Carlson. When I asked how things are going, she emailed me and just said, we're all hooked up with Exceed. Been working great, and thanks for all the efforts and hard work. With that, I'll turn it over to Bob, and any comments or anything you want to talk about.
I just talked to Wendy today. The repeaters are hooked up now. This is campus-wide, and we're getting the service we've got. We're paying for 25 megabit speed, getting like 45 if you're hardwired, but if you're on Wi-Fi, you always lose a little. So the Wi-Fi is still showing up around 25, which, you know, for the most part, that's going to rock your world. And now when you have a meeting in our dining hall and you want to make a presentation, now you can do it. It'll stream the video. You know, we've had issues before. But, you know, the biggest thing was with when you had a line that came in, they were selling a 6 megs down was their guarantee, except it really meant 2. Yeah, well, then you've got, 17, 18 employees trying to access. But then you've got other people, you know, making demands on the system. And, I mean, that crashes immediately. And it's been a nightmare, absolute nightmare. So, but, Ross, this, I think you've heard this. The word has gotten out. But Long Lake had a history of some difficulties the last number of years. But we got some wonderful staff out there in management that are just doing a bang-up job. But there's been positivity. Mm-hmm. And this came in. This is another positive thing. Mm-hmm. Well, at our foundation meeting this month, Wendy announced that for the first time in a great many years, Long Lake finished the year in the black.
That deserves a round of
applause. Books aren't audited, but they're pretty safe.
barring
some little somebody saying, well, you can't deduct that or something or whatever, but no, I'm very confident we're in the black this year. Mm-hmm. So, cool.
Nice. Yeah, it's been another great project. Anything else, Bob, or any other questions or comments?
Well, I would just say that if you're talking to a school about bringing, you know, 30, 40, 50 kids up to a location, and they were there last year, and there was no internet, and, you know, I can imagine 50 kids, you know, okay, it's dark, go to bed, right, it's 10 o'clock, or, you know.
Bill, understand this, and Wolf Ridge does the same thing. Leave your cell phones at home.
Oh. You know,
you're at an environmental learning center, folks.
There you go.
You know, this is kind of part of the reason you're here.
Mm-hmm. You know? Okay, good enough. So,
Well, it's one of the things, too, because there are like 200 students at a time, and even at 25 megs down, you're getting into our more gigabit required kind of thing for that many to start accessing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so, but.
And you can tell them, but how many actually leave their devices at home?
Yeah, well, of course.
Well, the parents and the teachers probably have their devices.
The students, you know.
But you know, the one thing I'll say that I went satellite here a couple of years ago, and at first it was a little clunky, and they had some, you know, the biggest restriction was that you had data caps. Well, that's why it wasn't a viable option for Long Lake ever, because you're going to use more data. Unlimited now. You get a decent speed, and we have an upgrade path, even with Exceed, we can go one level higher. And who knows, you know, because if we do want to open it up to more of the students and give them, you can do individual logins. You don't have to open your system up to everybody and your brother. You can just say, for today, here's your login, and you 20 can use this, you know, so and that probably will be done. But yeah, after the meeting, I want to talk to you and interview at least, not all of you.
That's good.
Well, that go to meeting thing, I mean, I've heard of it, I've never seen it, never used it. We need that set up a Long Lake, and you're a guy, as I understand.
Well, I've used it.
Okay, well.
I've never set it up.
Well, whatever. Okay, Carrie, did you do that?
You know, go to meeting, you can go just go online and download the app and get a subscription, and it's not a technical
green is
challenge.
Green.
Okay. Yeah.
Well, I'm not afraid of technology, I just haven't.
It's that easy, you basically download it. Pay the subscription and invite somebody to jump.
But
join
see,
in.
That's the big thing at Long Lake. We couldn't have done this before. Mm-hmm. You simply couldn't have had 6-8 people join your meeting. You know, now we can. So.
Mm-hmm. That's good. Well, moving along, this is kind of a combination of a phase one, phase two.
I need to go home.
In case Daryl all of a sudden accidentally got amnesia.
I got a bellyache.
The second, in talking with Daryl, what we found out is the initial layout did not cover Berglund Park. And Berglund Park and county-owned campsite in Palisade, it's been probably our best used campsite. It is right on the ATV trail.
Right on the river.
Yep, and right on the river. We recently put in a shower facility, flush toilets, electric.
That's awesome.
All that kind of stuff. It's kind of our, and because it is right on the trail. And of course, we all know, why you use resorts and campgrounds, Wi-Fi is almost as necessary as water. So anyways, this second go-around was a grant, $4,600 with a $1,320 match to extend the coverage to make sure we could get Berglund Park covered. The first initial project was for a Wi-Fi network in Palisade and Hill City, just under $9,000 grant and a $23,000 match. We know we have work to do on Hill City, and we don't know what exactly is going to happen.
I can give you an update on that.
There you go. I'll turn it right over to Daryl.
Okay. As it is, I have a history of 33 emails with the equipment vendor, and that's not Cisco. So I'm going to complain to Cisco over that, but I think with Monique's help, we've finally broken through to where we can get the equipment and start scheduling the installation. That's the good news. The bad news, and not so bad news, is that I went to the Hill City Chamber meeting.
Council
meeting, and pled with them to get on board and let us get the matching funds going so that I can focus my attention on getting them some free Wi-Fi for their economic development. First time I attended the meeting, they were all for it. Well, a few were for it, others were pretty silent. The Lions Club decided that it was a good idea, and they put in $400, which we put in the bank, kind of waiting for them to start cranking up the fundraising activity like Palisade has done. And I went back to the meeting just at the beginning of this month, and they were not happy with the line of sight installation that I could give them. They wanted Lakeside Park. So I went down and looked personally and took pictures of Lakeside Park. And it's a, I won't say it's a forest, but it's fairly thick with trees. Line of sight isn't a major issue when it comes to making it work. So when I tried to explain it to them, they said, we don't think that's going to be a reasonable solution to put the Wi-Fi hotspot where you want to put it. We want to put it there. Since then, backup plans, here we go. I talked to an influential Hill City resident, and he has assured me that he's going to twist some arms. So maybe we still get to do Hill City. Otherwise, we can work around that, possibly find another location, extend to Palisade even farther to make sure that we cover Berglund Park. I've got that in the plan already. That's phase two for me. And make sure that we have better coverage through the downtown area, which we're going to have plenty of coverage anyway. Getting to the coverage area, you can't see this very well, but if you look at it, this is Palisade. That's basically the whole city.
Anything that's shaded is City of Palisade.
This is. But this is the area that I'm concerned with working on right now. I can't compete with FCI for Wi-Fi, for internet, but I can bring in Wi-Fi hotspots. and by the end of next month for Bergman Park, weather permitting.
What did you need SCI to do for you? Did they have to come into town or just extend the fiber to the library or to the city hall?
SCI has a fiber source here, and I had to help them bring the fiber over to the city hall.
They ran it down the alley on the backside.
Yep.
Instead of tearing up the road.
Yeah. But they were good.
Which was really better a lot.
Thanks to Bill.
Good that they did. I mean, that was a major deal.
Yeah, and I'm glad. I appreciate your intervention, Bill, a lot. From there, like I said, once we hear about Hill City for sure, I think we're gonna find out that they looked a gift horse in the mouth and denied it in error. But we'll see what happens. If not,
what is their fundraising goal they need to meet, Daryl?
Half of the $3,000.
They've got roughly $1,200 to $1,500. Mm-hmm. They've come up with the Lions Club, they've come up with $400. Palisade had 1, 2, 3, 4 fundraisers. And I've heard from a birdie that the Lions Club is going to add another $200. So what is our total right now?
I don't know. I gave it to you. It's up there, and
it's near the $2,000 mark.
The city of Palisade did a very well job of doing and executing all the having raised that money.
Yeah.
But my problem is that if Hill City doesn't want it, and I've already talked to
Deanna, wasn't it?
No. I talked to what was that?
Diane.
No, she's
the Hill City clerk?
No, they won't even
she's
take
tall,
my call.
Dark hair. Oh yeah.
No. They're from the Triple RB.
Whitney?
Yes, thank you. And she said if we had a second route that we want to proceed, then let's do it that way, as long as everybody's in okay with it. Meaning that, as long as you guys are all okay with how we did it that way, instead of if Hill City wants to get canceled out.
You just have Mary's the approval person.
Oh, yeah, perfect. No, yeah, hi, you're my best friend.
If you have to come up with a plan B, just let us know. I'll give you my card and I'll
okay, perfect. There.
Right. I will say, from interacting with different people and different organizations in Hill City, they've been excited about the prospect of having free internet downtown. Now, I was shocked, honestly, when Daryl came back from the council meeting and they voted to not do it.
Well,
and it's like, well, wait a minute, your people want it, your community wants it. It's like, and we were talking, basically $100 a month to support the Wi-Fi service.
And it was like tourism kind of.
So, Marie, is this the city council?
Yes, they have to vote, yes. Well,
they want it at their park.
Yeah, they want it.
I guess for the same reason we wanted Berglund.
Right. Well, but see, that's a city park.
Is Berglund doesn't have a third or an eighth of the trees.
Right.
But see, that's the other thing is that that's a city park, and there's a difference. They own their park.
Yeah.
So they get entities for that park. We don't get the entities for Berglund Park per se. When they rent the spot, that goes to the county, right?
Yeah, right.
Yes.
So we don't get that entities as a city.
But the people in downtown Littleton, the businesses, the other people want it. Or not Littleton. Oh, my God, that's going back a while. 18 years, that's the last time.
Littleton, Colorado.
Yeah. The people in downtown Hill City want it. And their thing was that two bars have it in Hill City. Well, a lot of people don't go hang out by bars to get their
and
Wi-Fi.
So
it'll be interesting. There was, I was actually at a meeting and someone referred to, is it still Bill City?
Yeah.
And I was like, oh. And Daryl, he was like, he's with them on the VFW and some other things. And it's like, call Bill and ask him what he thinks about this.
Yeah.
And it was like, oh, no, the community wants it. We'll see what we can do. So,
yep. And I know who you're working with. I know Bill really well. So I'll help you out.
You're a real good man. Yeah. So that's where I'm at. That's my expected steps in the process and results coming.
Well, you've certainly been the magician to pull all these pieces together, and I can see how hard you've been working. I would just, from the foundation's perspective, we all see what a mistake it would be for Hill City to miss this opportunity. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And I would just encourage you to go the extra mile to help them see reason. And
that's what I've been doing. Yeah. That's why I'm using some background resources.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But well, I can see a few of their points up there. A few of theirs is that, what is the downtown of Hill City?
Nothing.
A couple of restaurants, a couple of bars that support it. They want it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just saying, they do.
And
a few of the gas stations want it too.
And a couple of
what would it take to do both the park and the downtown?
Well, that's a city thing, so they would have to do that.
The park, because of the sheer number of trees.
Yeah, I've been to that park.
The shortness of the poles.
Yeah.
It doesn't give me the capability to maximize or even to get the range to save any money at all on equipment and installation and all that. I'd need probably 6 times the amount of access points to cover that park because I can only put them 45 feet apart.
Okay.
Rather than put a pole in, would that help if they put a pole with an
then I could use an access point, that'd be great. But there's still leaves and trees. So I'd have to put in some kind of...
So you'd have to have another access point somewhere lower.
Yeah.
What about if they just run the line down there and have the main access point down there at the... And then another one up on the main street?
I talked to SCI, and that probably wouldn't be a problem.
It's probably the cheapest.
But I talked to SCI, and SCI says, we're ready for City Hall. We're ready. We can do it right there, right now. I haven't talked to them about any other... location. They have Hill City wired. So that might not be an issue either. You know, maybe I could talk to Scott again and see what he's got over there. But the biggest issue are the trees.
Well, which is ironic when you consider that the blowdown and the storms that they've had up
yeah.
in the one place that
yeah.
you can't put in Wi-Fi is there's all the trees
yeah.
in the
yeah.
park.
Yeah. Any more comments, questions?
Well, we got some issues. We're on a path, hopefully, to figure it out. And
we can, yeah, we can go forward with the stuff.
As to what
I have to say, I
successful.
Have better internet.
yeah, we got SCI.
I have better internet. I don't get bumped out anymore.
Like I said, I 31, 32, 33 email messages trying to get the equipment.
And well, the fact that we got SCI or you got SCI to move into town at the got the
awesome.
Fiber increased, I mean, that's a good thing right there.
That, and the good news for Hill City is that SCI plans to do the whole city, 2018.
Nice.
Plans are plans. They don't get done until you see results, but, you know, that's what they committed to.
Well, that's the ultimate goal for all of this, that at some point, we don't need mobile or Wi-Fi hotspots.
Right.
We don't need
mm-hmm.
the...
Right.
Repeater rings and stuff, but
right.
In the meantime, we do. So.
Yeah, exactly.
Daryl, what is SCI going to deliver there in Hill City? What service do they offer?
They got 100 up, 100 down. I measured it with the speed test right after they first put it in, and I got 70, roughly 70. They measured it the other day when I was in the office, and I got about 25. So I'm going to call them and find out why I've lost the bandwidth.
Oh, I can tell you why. There's a few of them that sit behind the city hall and get free internet.
Well,
which is fine. I don't
care. That's what we're going to do anyway.
Yep.
And that's fine. If I lose some
yep.
of that means that I've got to get in and change that to restrict that second band. Because they're looking at movies. And we need to restrict that on our Wi-Fi hotspot areas. There's two different bands.
Any other questions, comments?
Thank you.
I can see
thank
if
you.
Not but for Daryl, we wouldn't be here on this project. Working hard.
Well,
yes, city
yep.
wins the day.
Well, Monique has been an awesome partner.
Super.
You know, She's held my hand when I've been crying.
There you go.
That's your wife.
He's got his work wife. He's got his home wife.
Thank you. Well, last but certainly not least is, and thanks to the Blandon Foundation and the process of the administrative grant of $1,000, we have not figured out yet what we want to do with it. Had some real preliminary conversations with Carrie. What I'd like to do is something that we could put something on when all three of our conference centers are going. You bring in a speaker or a program or something. And you know, have as an educational piece as well, but also as a promotional piece. Let people know what can be done and what can be done here. So that's probably a next step. And as Carrie said, a lot of the stuff is just getting put in.
That's a great strategy. We've seen in a couple other of our communities that people do community events to really showcase the new technology and create a buzz. I think that's a really good
Well, you know, how do you, and how do you get the word out? And so, yeah, I mean, like even for me, I'm not real tech savvy. I have no idea how this stuff works or what can be done. Mm-hmm. And so if we can get more people in this room like that, then hopefully everybody can come out and get something. And we're doing our business retention and expansion visits, and so we're bringing that up to people that maybe have a home office in Staples and they don't want to drive back and forth and everything. So we're getting the word out as much as we can so this service can get used. The last thing we want with any of this stuff is to sit and gather dust.
One of the things that some communities have done with centers like this is to have work with the veterans office at the county and or at the is your National Guard or wherever you have people deployed to use this for the family could come in and video conference like with the family wherever they are. And this is nice because it's a semi-private. You know, I remember one group said, oh, we're going to do like the vet, you know, families talk to their service members at the fair or something. It's like, you know, it's an emotional thing, right? So privacy is important. So, but to have this kind of thing where you could say, okay, well, if you want to video conference with your military families, that would really be a nice, kind of a nice headliner kind of thing too that spreads the word.
So maybe we can work out something that, that the veteran service officer would want to come to, all the workforce people.
Mm-hmm.
We'll come up with something.
I just had a thought, the group doesn't repeat things that may not be true. I forgot the thing with satellite internet, you got 25 to 45 down. You only got 5 to 6 up. So that may limit us a little bit on some of this. Although Skype works, so I...
Well, it's good to hear that Skype works, because that's one of the major things about the satellite is the delay.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So that on a fiber connection, you might have a 10 millisecond delay.
Yeah, and then you got 600 on.
600 or 800 on a satellite. So that makes it more like talking like on a two-way radio.
Sometimes
more
on a Skype. Wait.
Mm-hmm.
But even for a meeting where you needed a vote or something cast, it'll still work for that.
Yes.
I mean, we're looking forward to the day, too, that we get actual fiber in there. But we had a center that's in, you know, desperate need of functionality. And if it's...
A veteran center, you mean?
No, the Long Lake
Center. Oh, the Long Lake Center,
But, you know, even if we're two, I talked to their technical department. We're like 2 years away from being successfully getting a gigabit speed into the center. So, you know, this bought us 2 years to be functional rather than, and I'll tell you, that's the difference between surviving and not surviving, being able to do this. You know, so.
Well, I'd like to say gruel tastes pretty good if that's all you got, right?
Yeah.
So if you're starving, you know, for no bandwidth, then all of a sudden you have the gruel, you say, more gruel, please.
Yeah.
But the, you know, once you have really good internet there, then you say, well, this 25.3 is driving me crazy.
Do you remember AOL?
No, I'm not that old.
Oh, that's old, man. That's so old.
I got a brother still on AOL.
That was quick.
But, yeah, I mean, and so that's essentially as the technology changes generations so quickly forget about, you know, how tough it was before, right? You know, this is the way it's always been. People start to think that, oh, you know, but it's not. And so this is, I agree with Ross's comments on the, you know, these more things you can chunk off. Like if Hill City gets brand new, you know, cable modem network and throughout Hill City, you know, that's one more place that has good internet in Aiken County.
Right.
So. And I don't know if you're going to talk at all about your progress you've made on the infrastructure side with your partnerships and grants and.
I have not. I can.
You know. I don't know if that's the last. There we go. So.
Oh no! I'm sorry. Hey. Actually, we had more.
It just keeps on coming.
Yeah.
Wow. Hits keep on coming.
This is our Aiken County landing page. This was our phase one. IRBC grant was for $6,000 with a $2,000 match. It's a partial screenshot, so you can hit all events where that one is, and you can kind of see where the 24th is blocked. And if I could have gotten the whole screen on there, it would have listed three or four different events that are going on. Not all of the areas have, you know, calendars, so it was a combination of who has a calendar, because these bots go and they scrub it. We're still working on some of the bugs. One of the things that has happened is some of the organizations up there changed how they do things. The McGregor Chamber went from their web page to a Facebook. So then that had to get readjusted and stuff. So we're working through that. But the idea is you can come on to the the event, AikenCountyEvent.com. And go on, you can click the individual on the left-hand side or on top, whatever, if you want to narrow it to the one community, or you can just hit all events and all the events show up, and as you can see, you can skip, go backwards, go forwards, and whatnot. And two other things, on the right-hand side is the other. So if there's an event, like the McGregor Lions Club have their annual event, it, you know, we can add things. You know, they don't, they're no use keeping a calendar, monitoring that, you know, if they only have one event a year. So we have the ability to add things. And
call that fun stuff.
Fun stuff, yes. For the non-fun stuff, that border across the top is actually from the Aiken County homepage. And so, like, under community, you can click onto that, and that'll have the link to, like, the Aiken County Historical Society, to the cities. I think there's a city township page, because that was one of the questions that I got asked is, well, will we be putting the city council meetings and the county board meetings? And I said, no, we want fun stuff. This is more of a tourism thing, and either keep people in the county and moving around or let them know what's going on. And my thought is, somebody's going to be coming to the Aiken County board meeting, they'll make that effort and they'll know. But yet if they don't, they can still get onto the community or the directory on the top there and still get to other organizations and events.
So Ross, what are you using just to find the calendars? I guess, is it a Google Calendar sufficient?
Google Calendars is what they like the best.
Okay, so if we have one for, say, exercise classes for care, we have exercise classes, or we have health fairs or things like that.
Yep.
That it'll find those. Okay.
Well, no, what you have to do is you send me an email with that information and your link where that is.
Yep.
And then we can add that to the top.
Okay, great, thank you.
Yep. Our PCs for People, another great program, and again, I got to think Carrie and Denise for really carrying the load on this, but we signed up for extra computers, which was made available to us. We're very grateful for. So we ended up with, I believe it was actually 84, and two of them didn't work. So out of the 82, we ended up distributing. 10 went to Aiken County Health and Human Services, that they in turn will distribute. Aiken County Care, same to distribute, and some of their own use. McGregor Angels, they're an organization designed to help keep people in their homes longer in the McGregor area. They took 6 to distribute Aiken County. Habitat for Humanity, the Palisade meeting room that Daryl had referenced earlier, got a couple. McGregor Community Ed took 15 for their use and also to distribute in that community. The ADA took 6, that's the Aiken County Advocates Against Domestic Abuse. Oh, thank you.
Yep.
Wonderful. And I'm going to pass it around if you want to see that.
Yeah.
Great. Just read it, Ann.
Okay.
I'm not going to read somebody else's.
Hill City Community Ed is also will be distributing Jaques Art Center to the Aiken County Day Activity Center. Got a couple of McGregor Kids Plus, the Historical Society, and then in addition to the organization that we're distributing, 19 individuals were able to come and get a computer as well.
We just started making phone calls to the different organizations that we work with to see if they had a need or if they were working with people that might have a need. And the need was overwhelming, so it was easy to distribute them.
Yeah. I was really surprised. I thought we were going to have a really hard time distributing our 50, and as it turns out, we probably could have used more.
Carrie,
you
have to carry
them
out of this building.
Yeah, I was going to say, 82 was enough.
Yeah. Carrie, on the Jaques Art Center.
Oh, that's a big
one. Are they using them in the facility itself?
Yeah, and they offer classes to artists and for students. Yeah. So I bring my cousins there every month, and so it was a big help.
And the same thing with the Historical Society, I presume, they have available for
to do some ancestry searches and things.
Funny story with the Jaques, we had a CSET meeting, mm-hmm. and we were talking about different classes and what we were going to offer, and one of the directors from Jaques said, oh, you know, we would really like to do a lot of stuff, but we don't have any computers. And Carrie and I look at each other and like, oh, hey.
How fun.
They were so grateful.
Yeah.
That's neat. And I think we have one more.
Oh, I'm sorry, I'm slacking. No. I was reading the list.
And, of course, the most important thing is a thank you to the Bland and the IRRRB. We could not have done this without your help, and so we are very grateful that you chose us for your program. Kind of all started, look back to our community listening sessions, just about a year ago, back in February of 2017. That in itself I felt was a big success, just bringing people from all over the county. Overwhelmingly, you could all, probably 70-80% of the projects or the requests and things that people brought up had something to do with access and access to broadband. Wi-Fi, portable, mobile Wi-Fi came up many, many times. Even if you, the things like the conference center, really it's all about access and getting the broadband. So I like to think that we listened and came up with projects. And the total tally, give or take, some of the dollar amounts got rounded. But our projects all added up to $101,874.09, of which $76,845, actually I think it's 46, came from the Iron Range broadband community grants, and the local community came up in a little over $25,000 in matches. So thank you.
It was a wonderful meeting at Long Lake. I'm just looking at you, Bob. Were you there at that meeting? February. Yeah, the a year ago, February, the visioning meeting.
Yes.
We were there.
Ross, do you want to talk about your infrastructure progress?
We have, in addition to this, again, because just such a lack of broadband. I mean, as everybody knows, we're like the lowest. I think we might be the third from the bottom now on access to broadband speeds that meet the state guidelines. So there's one major thing that's going on is what's called CAF2, and that's a federal program that both Frontier and CenturyLink access to bring to increase their speeds of broadband into Aiken County. The CAF2 guidelines is it 10 up and 1 down?
Mm-hmm.
And the state guidelines,
and
the state guidelines are 25 and 3. So there's a disconnect or a difference between projects that are getting funded through the federal guidelines or federal standards and those with the state. And even with the federal, the guidelines we're hearing is it's very limited. And so, you know, we just looked at it and said, in and back up a little bit, we had done some surveys. We found that of the businesses, almost everyone that was in the CenturyLink area had issues. It was not fast enough. It wasn't, I mean, they just, things they couldn't do. Frontier side of the county was a little bit better, but not much. And so with that, and I've also through the course of time, I've had four realtors that have told me at one time or another that they have lost sales in Aiken County because of the lack of broadband speeds. And if you're looking at an area, and they're cabin sales and second home kind of things, which is, you know, extremely important to our economy, it's not that they necessarily might go to another part of Aiken County. I mean, they look at Aiken, they look at Brainerd, Grand Rapids, Detroit Lakes, Fergus. I mean, there's just a whole area. Most people don't really care. They want their lake home, and they want, you know, the facilities. So we started a program. We had $450,000, and we set aside just for broadband projects that would meet the state speeds. And the idea, and it's not a lot of money. It's $150,000 a year for 3 years. But with all the projects and basically the digging is that's going on, we went to the providers and said, if you had a little bit more money, you're already doing a project. Could you extend it? You know, we've heard horror stories where, you know, a line might be coming down if they had just crossed this road and you could get that whole other shoreline of the lake. So we put that out there. And so between that project, two of our providers have also received state border-to-border broadband grant money. Mille Lacs Energy along with CTC. So what they have done as part of that is they brought a second fiber line into Aiken to the Mille Lacs Energy headquarters, brought that back into our industrial park. What was one of a weak point in our industrial park is now a strong point because of the internet speeds they can get there. They've extended that to the south. Another company, SCI, has been brought up. They're very good to work with. They actually received our grants the first go around, and that was to extend service up in Shamrock Township, in an area that, you know, Shamrock Township is the highest valued entity or governmental unit in Aiken County. It's actually the city of Aiken, you would think, would be the highest valued. It's actually like the fourth. We have three townships that are all lakes. With lake home, hardly any commercial businesses at all, but they have higher valuations than the cities. And Shamrock is number one. And so,
because of the quality homes.
Yes, yep, the price of the homes. Yep. For three or four cabins would be about four blocks worth in our typical community, and that's
the 36 square miles.
Yeah, and it is a larger area, and I mean it's Big Sandy Lake. I mean that's mm-hmm. that is the premier lake in our county. So they were able to, they took a grant and did what's called Bridge Road. And by doing that, they didn't use our money as a match, but they put in and they were happy enough with the response that they got on Bridge Road that they put into a state grant to do all of Shamrock Township. So, and that was kind of what we wanted to do, was just get a little bit more fiber in the ground so then the businesses could come and do that. And then the other grant we gave was also to SCI. Down on the north shore of Mille Lacs Lake, if you're familiar with, kind of like from Malmo to just beyond, like, say, the Red Door, just the geography of it, there's a long stretch of Mille Lacs Lake, that the lower road is right on the lake, so there's no homes, it's nothing, there's a lot of state land, so there's kind of an island there, and within that is three resorts. So SCI was able to come down and do that project. That's actually going to get done next year, and we know we're having success, and that people are noticing, because now we've been getting some correspondence with CenturyLink, asking, well, why can't we work together? Why does the county? They contacted the admin. they contacted the chair of the county board, who then turned it over to our administrator and said, yes, we'd like to meet, and, you know, we'll bring our economic development. No, we want to just meet with you, so.
Yeah.
I see it as a positive, and you know, the answer is real simple. If you guys want to come in and do this, go at it.
Right.
And the other side of the coin is they could have applied for the grant, too. Frontier did put in for a grant, and so it's not exclusive just to the small providers. So that's our project, and the 927 exchange, with which is most of the, and as well as 678, CenturyLink will be upgraded. You know, I got a call from somebody down in that area, and they claimed they got DSL. I'm thinking it was actually a faster speed. They were happy with that. You know, they'd gone from dial up to a faster speed, and they were like, oh my goodness, you know.
More gruel.
I remember we were thrilled when we got that little
3 years on.
Oh, what a difference. You know?
Ross, can I ask, at one point our broadband covered 27% of Aiken County. Has that percentage changed at all?
You know, I haven't seen the maps lately.
Dennis says in April, was it April, mm-hmm. she said, that we'll have new, the state will have updated
That's
maps.
That's what they're saying. Otherwise, I can see the last one right here in a second.
One of the issues of that is that the state says everything that's less than 25 down and 3 up is unserved. And some of that cap 2, where somebody goes from nothing to 10 down or 15 or 20, that would still be considered unserved. So the map won't really change.
Okay. We're not on the map.
And that's kind of the challenge of, you know, the places that have 100% fiber or have good new cable modem networks, you know, they can do 1,000 megabits now.
Yeah.
And so the cable modems like SCI, they would say we sell a gig, but it'd be 1,000 down and about maybe 50 up. But again, there aren't that many people who need more than 50 megabits up.
No.
You know, and certainly it uses the, you know, to do the job. It
so that 27% is an fair assessment.
What's
and
that?
And that 27% is an fair assessment in terms of actually, we're actually getting broadband in other places. It's just not measured because it's not up to that standard, is what you're saying.
Well, and some people would say now that anything less than 25 megabits isn't really, it's the new dial-up.
Oh.
So that's, so that if you have less than 25 megs, you're essentially on broadband dial-up. And because other people, the way things are being designed is now for, you know, 50 megabits, 100 megabits. So in the Twin Cities metro area, Comcast just said, we're increasing everyone's speed by 50 megabits. So they just throw that in, you know, you're at 100, now you're 150. And so that's kind of the pace of change. But I'm not going to disagree. If you had nothing, or, you know, if you had a good DSL connection, that would be better than a 10 megabit DSL connection. Probably be better in a lot of ways than a satellite connection at 25, because of the lack of delay and other things.
Sure.
And not affected by weather and
it
probably would, if you had satellite in the Twin Cities on Monday afternoon, it probably wasn't working very good because the snowflakes are.
That's the thing with download speed though, and just being, just a hair over novice, you know, I use my computer every day a lot. But, you know, I've been telling people, everybody's making this contest about how many megabits down do you get? You know, and it's like, well, it's like a status symbol.
Mm-hmm.
I said, it really doesn't matter after 20 or so, because it just depends on how many people are logged on.
Mm-hmm.
Your movies won't play any better. Your email won't come in any faster. You know, it's just that if you've got 100, you can have 20 people using it.
I think you should try a gigabit connection, and you would probably say that's a little...
Well,
you would find a difference.
I
it's like
Ross,
if you have a nice TV, I mean, that's the difference between a black and white TV or even a 27-inch color TV compared to a 60-inch 4K TV.
Okay.
You say, well, it's still TV, but it's a different thing.
Oh, right, a different level. Well, I told Ross, when I got up to Bemidji and they put me up in a hotel there, geez, they gave me 50, you know, except it's on fiber, so there is none of that delay. I'm used to 25 on satellite.
Mm-hmm.
That little
thing.
You know, all that really amounts to, though, if like you're streaming movies, is when it starts, it'll just give you one little waiting thing, and then it's fine. It just keeps going because it's bigger packets.
Yeah.
But if you were doing anything telehealth related.
Right.
Well, see, that's where.
That's upload speeds, too.
Yeah.
The other
issue. One thing when you're watching a movie.
I was just agreeing with you because
yeah.
when I ran my same computer, I just took my laptop with me. And I went,
yeah.
Wow, the website.
Well,
this is. Turns out my computer is a lot more capable than I thought it was.
Yeah. And the other piece now is with the Netflix, it's smart enough to know how fast your connection is. It only gives you enough.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Because
right.
if you had a, you know, it's like you drink, you know, sip wine, you use a beer bong, right? I mean, these are information flows. And so if you're, you know.
They don't do beer
yeah.
bong
no.
anymore, do they?
I don't think they ever did a beer bong, did they? Wine, never mind.
But he's drinking.
I guess
beer.
I'm young.
But I mean, it's a difference all that. You know, if you're a smart person, you actually want a slower
yeah.
connection to your drinking glass. But,
yeah.
you know, the idea is that these new technologies that, you know, now these 4K TVs require a lot of bandwidth
okay.
to make them look good. So if you're up in a nice cabin, lake home, and you've got a crummy internet connection, you're trying to stream something on a big, nice, fancy new TV,
right.
it would look terrible.
Yeah.
So I
follow you.
Yeah.
But you know, when you get older and your eyes aren't the best anyway, it really isn't going to matter.
Yeah, there you go.
So. Well, I think for us, for doing some projects with seniors, it's what can we access and what can they access remotely.
Yeah,
we have
yeah.
a lot of people who cannot or should not be driving. And the
yeah.
telemedical appointments is exciting
yeah.
to me.
Yeah.
Being able to order prescriptions online and having them delivered to your home is exciting. We're actually doing a grant. We got a grant to do some grocery home delivery. And so ideally people will be able to order some groceries, place some groceries online.
Yes.
You know, those kinds of things, those are essential to the quality of life and being able to remain independent in your home. You know, it's the movies, the streaming, all that other stuff that's nice and wonderful, and that's great for entertainment. But in terms of actually being able to do your banking, to do contact your VA, you know, to do Social Security type stuff, you know, do any of those
mm-hmm.
things that are essential to
emergency health care.
Well,
emergency, yeah.
And if we made it perfect in the beginning, we'd lose one of the three things everyone needs to live. You know, that someone to love, something to do, and something to look forward to.
Sure.
If it was perfect to start with, we'd have nothing to look forward to.
yeah.
And I really celebrate your progress. And I think the Aiken model of, you know, county says, we want to be involved. We can't finance $30 million worth of infrastructure in our county, but we do have these funds dedicated for economic development. And how do you use them to build infrastructure, leverage new dollars to come in? You know, that's a great, you know, where else... To help a resort would have taken the whole $500,000. But now you've helped three resorts and everyone else
well, you
with
know,
a $500,000.
A little background to that is, you know, we tried, that was our first approach, was let's just wire the whole county, you know, easy. And, you know, then obviously, again, with all the different providers in the county, which is a challenge, we sat down with CTC out of Brainerd. And they had an estimate to do, would be the southwest quadrant of the county, which is basically the Farm Island, Cedar Lake, Ripple, that area, not going as far as the North Shore of Mille Lacs Lake, and that was about $20 million. And so that would have been, like I said, that would have been 20 to 25% of the county. You extrapolate that out to the whole county, you're looking at something like $80 million, and it's just... There's just no way you could do it. There's no way you could do $20 million. And if you could, as a county, how do you decide that these people get it and not these people?
Yep.
You know, and you know, we're already running into that. Well, how come we can't have exclusive use of this money?
Yeah.
We don't cover the whole county exclusively, so we can't
internet,
do that, you know.
Main street, you know, the whole world.
No, but that's a great,
yeah.
I mean, you've served a lot of new houses now, or
yep,
so a lot of places have coverage now that wouldn't have. Just to get a state grant now, you have to have a technology that can, some point in the near term, deliver 100 megabits symmetrical, 100 down, 100 up. So that's what, when you people are getting a state grant, that's kind of the standard that they're set to, that what you're putting in has to support, and that's a mushy kind of term that they use, scalable to 100 bank symmetrical, but it generally involves investment
fiber.
In fiber optics.
Yeah. Is that to each connect one? That's what the courthouse has. You know, and that services the whole system.
And so it's a future orientation because you're building a infrastructure. And so the idea is that the state, before they're going to put their money in it, they don't want to put money into something that in 10 years is going to be obsolete. So they're trying to say, okay, we're building a foundation of infrastructure.
Tell them about it, Joel. He's a treasurer of the DFL. They've got this god-awful program they've got to use. You talk about something
that's
they've never
scaled
up.
The whole state finance board uses the same old program.
So he wanted to see if he had to reinstall the program. He went into the instructions. Take the diskettes and
the floppy. They wanted to put floppy disks on it. It's a DOS system. You're still using DOS.
They do that because somebody down in the cities is an old dog, and he likes that program, and they're going to use it until he retires.
Well, we won't have to worry about being hacked.
No.
You have to know DOS.
Big systems get complicated. We see that now with the license plate registration stuff. It's not easy. The healthcare.gov site. I mean, no one hears anything bad about that now. But four years in, or whatever, it took a while to make it work. So the status quo for a lot of government people is, hey, good enough, baby. It's still working every day. So.
Or until they retire.
That's
the next person.
Which they know how many days that is. So.
Mm-hmm. Well, looking down the road, we do, many of you were able to participate last year in our Day on the Hill, and we're going to, the Minnesota Rural Broadband Coalition.